Speculative evolution, or speculative biology, can be defined as a genre focused on hypothetical scenarios in the evolution of life. Today, speculative evolution is everywhere, from video games to graphic novels to any of the hundreds of amazing online projects that explore worlds beyond our own. But how did we get here? Interest in the biology of fictional life wasn't always so widespread. Monsters from ancient myth weren't typically thought of to be part of an ecosystem. They just kind of existed. The origin and rise of speculative evolution as we know it today is a fascinating tale, deeply intertwined with scientific advancement and full of unexpected twists. So, for this special entry into the archive, I'll give you the full tour of this genre's incredible history and reveal the evolution of speculative evolution. Let's start by winding back the clock to 1895. It's been almost 40 years since Charles Darwin published his theory of evolution, this foundational idea that all species gradually change over time, and through the process of natural selection become better suited to their environment. And by the turn of the century, the scientific community and the majority of the educated public had accepted evolution as a fact. At this time, in a small town in the English countryside, science teacher turned author H.G. Wells came up with an idea for a story. Called The Time Machine, the novel follows an intrepid English inventor on his journey into an imagined future. The novel represented a lot of firsts for science fiction, and has been adapted into numerous films, most famously in 1960. In both the novel and the film, upon arriving into the distant future using his titular time machine, the protagonist realizes that Darwinian evolution has changed the English countryside beyond recognition. Not only is the world now populated with strange plant life unfamiliar to the time traveler, but humans have evolved as well, having split into a prey species, the uncanny childlike Eloi, and a predator species, the secretive subterranean Morlocks. The 1960 film portrays the Morlocks as these weird, yeti-like things, an effect that hasn't aged particularly well. But their description in the novel is more ominous, with the narrator likening their appearance to subterranean fish, their bodies slick and bleached from millennia spent adapting to the caverns. Most of the science in this section is now somewhat outdated, but the story doesn't end here. While this first section of the novel is most popular, and the only one covered in film adaptations, the truly groundbreaking chapters come after. The time traveler then journeys millions of years forward, and encounters a barren version of Earth lit by a dying red sun. On a ruined shoreline, the time traveler sees that giant crab-like creatures have evolved and now keep a grim vigil over this dying land, a sight that nearly shatters his psyche. Pushing even further into the future, he witnesses the final days of Earth, where upon a blood-red sea, an indescribable mass of tentacles rises from the water, a visual so beyond his 19th century comprehension it causes his mind to collapse. Fitting for a novel about time travel, this section feels impossibly ahead of its time. It doesn't read like something written over 30 years before the invention of sliced bread. By speculating on what life might look like millions of years beyond his own time, Wells had inadvertently opened the door to a whole new literary genre, the genre of speculative evolution.
The people of Mars probably walk on their hind legs, their barrel-chested bodies covered with a coating of down. Their ample skulls would be crammed with intelligence, and their trunk-like noses indispensable for feats of engineering.
The next great frontier in speculative evolution would emerge that same year, when astronomer Percival Lowell produced an account of what he believed to be canals on the surface of Mars. What we now know to be an optical illusion caused by streaks of dust was at the time believed by some to be evidence that there was complex life on the next rock over from Earth. Inspired by these findings, H.G. Wells would publish The War of the Worlds just 2 years after The Time Machine, a novel notable for popularizing the alien invasion story. Wells' tale about Martians invading Earth is widely interpreted as commentary on British imperialism. Yet War of the Worlds could also be considered another founding work of speculative evolution. Before the book's release, Wells published numerous articles speculating about what life on Mars might look like, discussing his theories for how plant and animal life might evolve. We now know that Mars can't support life for a range of reasons, but at the time, this was reasonable scientific conjecture. It's interesting to read these articles because they really feel like someone gushing about a speculative world they've created. And the early ideas for the Martians and their planet Wells outlines are almost unchanged in War of the Worlds, which suggests this little project inspired the massively influential follow-up. One of the most important sci-fi novels ever began with the author dreaming about speculative ecosystems.
Today, a space-conscious public avidly consumes tons of story material about life on other planets.
In the 20th century, the War of the Worlds would inspire numerous other invasion stories, which tended to echo public perceptions of threat. Bolstered by reports of supposed UFOs and a rising public interest in everything space-related, science fiction stories based on threats from the stars became a common form of entertainment. Yet with a few exceptions, these aliens weren't quite speculative in the way Wells' early work was. They were more things that went bump in the night. What ecosystems or evolutionary path created these aliens was rarely at the forefront of these stories. They were, essentially, fantasy monsters, with their speculative biology an afterthought at best. In the 1950s especially, the aliens of Hollywood came to represent fears of communist infiltration, with the paranoia that agents of the enemy were everywhere manifesting as literal aliens in disguise.
Through the years, there have been frequent rumors that Martians disguised as Earthmen walk amongst us. These stories are perhaps strengthened by the thousands of reports of unidentified flying objects passing in an endless procession across our skies.
While the initial speculative intrigue that inspired Wells to write War of the Worlds in the first place had largely been forgotten by the midpoint of the 20th century, some lesser-known speculative projects did emerge during this time. In 1957, animation director Ward Kimball got funding from Walt Disney to create Mars and Beyond, an animated special most famous for depicting what conditions on Mars might be like given sufficient water. With advice from astronomer Dr. E.C. Silfer, Kimball and his team brought to life an impressively alien array of speculative life forms, like trilobite creatures that can endure Martian dust storms, fast-growing carnivorous plant life, and a slew of predators, including one that incapacitates prey with poisonous gas, and another that stuns with ultrasonic waves. Perhaps most notable of all, one sequence also speculates on life based on entirely new chemical patterns, imagining organisms based on silicon instead of carbon, providing a range of surreal new forms. While Mars and Beyond would be largely forgotten over the following decades, the piece stands as remarkably innovative by the standards of its time. Throughout the same period, running parallel to the wave of aliens were stories which followed in the footsteps of the time machine and explored future and alternate evolution on Earth. In 1930, author Olaf Stapledon released the novel Last and First Men, which chronicles a speculative future of humanity across 2 billion years in 18 human species. The book is somewhat unwieldy, but it did anticipate the invention of genetic engineering. The next major work that didn't involve aliens came in 1961, with the account of naturalist Harold Stumpke's expedition to an island chain in the South Pacific. The report describes in detail a previously unknown order of mammals known as the Snouters. These mammals are distinguished by the nasarium, a structure derived from their nose, that has been adapted for all sorts of purposes. Reportedly, some used their noses for walking, others for ensnaring prey, and still others for rudimentary flight. If all this sounds too fantastical to be real, that's because it was a total fabrication. Harold Stumpke wasn't a real person, but the pseudonym of the real author Gerald Steiner, a zoologist who wrote and published his book on the Snouters to prank his colleagues. Yet the Snouters mark several important firsts in the history of speculative evolution. Containing a detailed taxonomic tree, and a surprising amount of thought put into the niches each Snouter fills. In fact, the tone itself is so dry and scholarly that it successfully mimics a scientific work, and has become something of a favorite prank among zoologists, with several scientists and publishers having written about the Snouters since as if they were real to keep the hoax alive. And when scientists actually discovered a new species of rodent with a uniquely large nose in 2015, they officially named the animal a Sulawesi Snouter, in honor of Steiner's fictitious creatures. While the Snouters project was limited to a single island archipelago, 2 decades later, in 1981, author Dougal Dixon would forever change the genre with his book After Man. Set 50 million years from now, After Man explored the biology of speculative life forms that have evolved following a mass extinction. To this day, After Man is recognized as the first truly large-scale speculative evolution project involving an entire world with a vast array of species. After Man also marks the first time the terms speculative evolution and speculative biology were used in writing to describe a work. Some of my favorite creatures from this project include the rabbits, which are rabbits that have evolved to fill the grazing niche of deer, or the enormous vortex, filter feeders evolved from penguins that fill the role left behind by whales. Perhaps the most famous creature from After Man is the Night Stalker, a nightmarish, fully terrestrial descendant of the humble bat. Dixon himself has stated the final chapters of Wells' The Time Machine were his primary influence in creating After Man, and the book can be considered a rebirth of the genre. The volume enjoyed widespread success across the globe, and was even made into a stop-motion animated adaptation in Japan, although the project was never translated. Following up on After Man's success, Dixon would create The New Dinosaurs, a book that explored a hypothetical alternate Earth where the Cretaceous-Paleogene extinction event never occurred, leading non-avian dinosaurs to evolve into the present day. The New Dinosaurs is one of the first entries in the alternate timeline subgenre of speculative evolution. Yet things became more complicated with Dixon's third book, the bizarre Man After Man, which explores the evolution of future humans. Various higher-ups altered the book heavily during development, and Dixon himself was reluctant to be involved in the final version of the project, due to its lack of scientific detail. It did give us this famous image, which has been turned into a meme, but following the book's publication, no projects like it were released for some time. In the early 90s, a different kind of speculative work would arrive on the scene in the form of Expedition. Created by artist and writer Wayne Barlow, Expedition surveyed the alien ecosystem of the fictional planet Darwin IV with the same level of detail that Dixon used when exploring future timelines. The creatures of Darwin IV were designed to be truly alien, with Barlow having grown dissatisfied with the common science fiction trope of alien life being similar to life on Earth. At the time of the book's publication, the kinds of aliens you'd see on TV were mainly actors with things glued to their foreheads. Yet the organisms of Darwin IV felt authentically like they'd emerged from a different evolutionary line, with none of them possessing eyes, hair, or external ears. And the most intelligent aliens of Darwin IV, the bizarre, floating Eosapiens, break the trend of aliens with human-like intelligence needing to appear humanoid. Following the success of Expedition, the book was adapted in 2005 into a CGI TV special for the Discovery Channel titled Alien Planet. Barlow served as the design consultant and one of the executive producers of the adaptation. Throughout the early 2000s, computer-generated television specials became a surprising haven for speculative works, including Charles Foley's Dragons of Fantasy Made Real, which explored the hypothetical evolution of a lost order of dragons. Joanna Adams's The Future is Wild also came out around this time, which explores future ecosystems in a nature documentary format. Dougal Dixon was actually one of the scientists who helped develop the project, and assisted in designing many of the lifeforms. The Future is Wild is a speculative project that remains unparalleled in terms of scale and ambition, and there's never really been anything like it produced since. During the latter 2010s, speculative evolution had a significant, if often overlooked, impact on popular culture. Dixon's The New Dinosaurs heavily influenced the direction of Peter Jackson's King Kong. Even James Cameron's Avatar, which remains one of, if not the most successful film of all time, owes heavy inspiration to art Wayne Barlow created for the movie. At the same time that speculative evolution was influencing mainstream media, there was also an explosion of availability in online projects. And leading the charge for early internet speculative works was one C.M. Kozeman. Born in Turkey, the young artist and writer released the book All Tomorrows onto the internet in 2006, a fascinating and disturbing narrative exploring future human evolution, both through genetic engineering and natural means. The book is something to behold, at once both nihilistic and strangely hopeful. Taking inspiration from works like Last and First Men, All Tomorrows steadily grew an online following. Around the same time, Kozeman also released updates for a story called Snyad, a world-building project exploring the biology of aliens on a fictional exoplanet. Influenced by works like Barlow's Expedition, the sheer number of invented creatures and lineages makes Snyad one of the most biologically diverse fictional worlds. A few years later, Kozeman would release All Yesterdays with artist John Conaway and paleontologist Darren Naish, a book that speculated on how dinosaurs might have looked and behaved. This speculation actually helped inspire projects like Prehistoric Planet. The book also contained a section titled All Todays, which explored how aliens might reconstruct Earth animals based on the fossil record with no knowledge of their biology. Like species filling niches of a new environment, speculative evolution would become a bigger and more complicated genre than ever thanks to online possibilities. The early works of artist Alex Rees also hit the internet around this time, showcasing stunning depictions of alien life. In particular, Alex Rees would explore the development of an intelligent hexapod species called the Birrin, creating one of the most fascinating and believable alien cultures across fiction. Leading up to the modern day, speculative evolution became more accessible than ever before, with a growing community of people inspired by the genre able to connect over vast distances. And today, speculative evolution is in the middle of a kind of renaissance. Creators like Christian Klein are now self-publishing entire speculative books like The Teeming Universe. Dylan Beta helped kickstart a new subgenre with Serena, which has popularized the idea of a seed world, a concept that involves leaving a few species on an empty planet and following their evolutionary path. Artist Roxy Valdez has continued the tradition of alternate timeline speculative evolution with their frog-centric Amphitera project. The sheer number of speculative projects being developed online right now is amazing, and the future of this genre is looking bright. The history of speculative evolution is a long and interesting road. I couldn't cover everything, especially since exactly what can be defined as speculative evolution is somewhat nebulous, but I hope this offered a helpful overview of the major milestones. And speaking of milestones, this video is releasing on the week of my channel's 1-year anniversary. Whether you're a longtime fan or a first-time viewer, it means so much that you've stopped by and helped make this channel possible. I've explored many of the projects mentioned here in greater detail, and I have lots of exciting things planned for the future. And as always, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this entry, please lend your support by liking, subscribing, and hitting the notification icon to stay up to date on all things curious. See you in the next video.